Hello and welcome to the Savera eCare On Demand webinar. I am Christy Seidel, Director of Telemedicine Education at Savera eCare in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Savera eCare is the largest telemedicine provider in the United States with more than 20 years of experience in the field. We are sharing some of the expertise in offering these quick and easy telehealth resources and training. Today's session is tips and tricks for engaging children in a virtual visit. And I have with me Amanda Allison, a nurse with the Savera eCare School Health Program. With that, I will turn it over to her. Welcome, Amanda.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to get started on this series for everybody. I think it will provide hopefully a lot of guidance and direction for people, whether you're new to telemedicine or whether this is something you've been doing for a while. I hope that everybody has a little something to gain from this. As Christy said, my name is Amanda. I'm an e-school health nurse, and I also work for the Sioux Falls School District. So I spend part of my day in a school setting and part of my day in a telemedicine setting, both for school health. Prior to that, I was a nurse in the pediatrics and pediatric intensive care at Savera McKinnon for 19 years, so I have nothing but pediatric experience. So with that, we're just going to get started. The first step really in preparing for a telemedicine visit is making sure that you're familiar with your equipment. The last thing you want to do during a visit is have to try to troubleshoot and not being familiar with or knowing how to use the different functions available to you. So part of that also is just the basics, making sure you know how to turn your camera off and on, making sure you know how to mute and unmute, turn your volume up, turn your volume down. All of those kind of things are important to know ahead of time. So practicing telemedicine calls prior to actually having a visit is extremely important. Also, you want to make sure that you're familiar with where your camera is and or cart on your patient end so that you get the view that you need, whether that's a kind of a bird's eye view. If you're looking at a student who's potentially lying on a cot, do you want to see them from kind of the feet up? Do you want the camera next to their head? What is the best view for you to provide the assessment and recommendations that you need? Directing staff that are with the student to move the camera or cart so that you get the best view. Also important is to remind staff that when they are assisting you and they're on the end with the student, that you don't necessarily need to see them. Oftentimes I have to direct, the feeling is that they want to be in the picture along with the student. But really what's most important is that your view of the student is clear and uninterrupted. Next, and this slide is extremely important. We're going to talk about eye contact. It is very, very different when you're providing a telemedicine contact versus in the clinic or in an actual health office. In order to give the perception of you making eye contact with the student, it's important that you look into your camera. And this is something that I have had to continually remind myself, even to this day, while I'm providing care via telemedicine. In the back of my mind, I'm saying, look at the camera, look at the camera, because you want to look at the student. It's natural for us to want to look at who it is we're speaking to, because that's how we do it when we're in a face-to-face interaction. But when we're on telemedicine, we need to look into the camera for them to feel like we're looking at them directly. There are times during a telemedicine visit, obviously, that you're going to need to look away. When you're providing that assessment, you're going to need to look at your screen to view the skin or to look into the ears, to look to see if there's any swelling on a sprain. And that's okay. That's appropriate. That's what we need to do to provide care. But when that happens, it's important for us to let them know that that's what we're doing. And just a simple statement of, now I'm going to look down at my screen so that I can see what's inside your ear and help figure out what it is that might be bothering you. Who is participating in the call? On the provider end, for us, it's a nurse that's providing care to the student in a school setting. On the patient end or student end, it could be another nurse in the building that has called you for assistance or a second opinion. It could be a secretary. That secretary may or may not be med-trained, depending on the setting. And so that's important for you to know if your direction is the student needs to have a medication administered. For example, they're an asthmatic who's having trouble breathing. You want to know whether that student is with someone who can do that for them. And if not, where is a person that can assist with that? It's often not uncommon to have a parent involved in the care of the student either. A lot of our students, especially in our small districts, have parents who work in the school. And so we'll call them into the office to assist with the call and also then provide recommendation. Making sure that the staff who are helping you on the student end have been trained is essential. Just like it's important for us to be familiar with our equipment, it's important for them to be familiar with the equipment as well. Knowing how to move the cart, how to adjust the volume, adjust the camera, but most important is making sure that they know how to use the peripherals that are available to them. Those are the tools that we will rely on to help us gather the best assessment data and then secondarily provide recommendations for treatment, for them to be referred to medical care, to rest, to go home, whatever it may be. Providing competencies for people who are on the student end in using these pieces of equipment is important. Doing training up front, having them demonstrate their ability to use it, but then also ongoing competency evaluation is important. The way that we do that is that we have at least weekly, if not, at least bi-weekly, if not weekly, check calls, where we call our staff in our schools that have this equipment and we do a practice. We make sure that all of the equipment is working like it needs to be. And then we also will open up and practice with a couple of the peripherals, again, just to make sure that they continue to be familiar with use. It's hard to learn a new skill and then not use it for several months, but we certainly don't want that skill to be lost when we have a situation that may come up when a student needs to be seen, especially if that situation is urgent. We want them to be proficient in using what they have available to them. Provider environment is really important in a telemedicine visit. When you walk into an office, for example, the environment is set, it's standard, you know what you're walking into. You know what the student or patient is going to see. But when we're providing telemedicine, that environment can vary. Some providers will be assisting students via telemedicine from their homes. Some will be in an office setting providing care. And so making sure that you know what your setting looks like. What do you look like to that patient and the people assisting them? And making sure that it's appropriate. So limiting noise is important. The microphones on telemedicine equipment are extremely sensitive and can pick up lots of noises that you may think are very quiet, but actually come through as quite loud. So making sure you're not typing while you're seeing a patient is important. Making sure that you're aware of noise around you. If you're in an office setting, making sure that your office mates are aware that you're actively participating in a call, so that they can be quiet, lower their voices if they need to speak. Making sure your cell phone is silenced is also important. Maintaining confidentiality, again, whether this is any kind of environment, is a priority for us. And so you want to be aware of who's around you. What can they hear? What can they see? Whether you're at home or in an office setting. Ideally, if you're able to use headphones, that helps immensely in providing confidentiality. Because then if there are people around you, they aren't able to hear anything that the patient is providing you verbally. So they won't know the name, the date of birth, they won't know the complaint or any of the other assessment findings. If that's not possible, using screens or making sure you have high noise limiting backgrounds that also limit visibility from people that may be passing by is important. Check your lighting. Lighting is important because, again, we want to have the student really be able to see us clearly. We don't want to be washed out or drowned out by light that's too bright, by sunlight that's maybe shining on us. We want to avoid any glares that could be coming through by making sure we don't have open windows or sunlight behind us. Also making sure that your backdrop is appropriate and that you don't have a lot of personal effects, pictures, things like that hanging up behind you is important. Also want to make sure that things around you that are within camera view are appropriate. So if you have a bottle of water, a coffee, that's okay, obviously, to have those things with you, but you want to make sure that they're not in camera view, and you want to avoid having anything to eat or drink during your call unless absolutely necessary. Chewing gum is another thing that is a no-no, so no gums, no mints, anything like that. Next, we're going to talk about the patient environment. One of the most important things about the patient environment, especially in a school setting, is maintaining confidentiality and HIPAA. This can be challenging, especially in a busy health office. There are sometimes 4, 5, 6 kids in a health office at once. Not that they all necessarily need to be seen by the school nurse, but they may be all in the office. So having dividers, if possible, curtains of some sort, so that the student you're seeing is given that privacy, especially during physical exams. If we need to look at a rash, for example, that maybe is on the tummy, we want to make sure that we're providing that privacy for the student. We want to limit any extra people in the office if we can. So if the other students in the office are there for non-urgent or emergent needs, if it's appropriate, asking those students to step out into a different area during the call, or because our carts are mobile, we have the option of moving the student to another area that can provide privacy if, again, that's appropriate. I have had experiences with students that are in the background. They come by, they see me on camera, they think it's TV, and they're waving and jumping up and down, and they think it's really fun. And so in those circumstances, definitely expected of that provider or nurse to say, I see that we have a visitor in the background, and so I'm just going to pause the call and ask your helper, whether that's a secretary or administrator, to please have the students in the background exit the area. Limiting distractions is extremely important with children. Children are easily distractible, and this is kind of a new, sometimes uncomfortable, sometimes scary experience for them. And so limiting distractions around them is important, because that will help keep their focus on you, which is where we need it to be. So if there's a TV in the background, limiting that, limiting side conversations of people who may be around them. Noise from the hallway, so shutting doors when possible. And even if you have a private area that you're able to close the door, putting some kind of signage on the outside, just letting people know that you are actively participating in a telehealth call. And so that will hopefully remind them to, again, be as quiet as they can and to not come in and interrupt that call. Preparing children for telemedicine visits is unique and important. Children are, I think, unfortunately, naturally fearful of going to the doctor or the doctor's office, because they relate that often to things that are going to hurt, like shots. And so we need to make sure that we're aware of that and that we're empathetic to their fears and to this new experience, and preparing them appropriately prior to moving into our assessment when able. Obviously, these things are going to look different if we have a student that comes into the office that's in an emergent situation. For example, if we have a student who comes in having an anaphylactic reaction, this is going to look different, because our priority in that situation will be to provide that emergent life-saving care. But for kiddos who come into the office who have cold symptoms or an earache, or maybe twisted their ankle on the playground, these are kids that we're going to want to take a little time at the beginning of that call to just prepare them, help them become more comfortable and familiar with us, make them feel a little more at ease in order to gain the best information from them when we get to the assessment piece. So providing developmentally appropriate care is important. Remembering that children are developmentally not always the same as they are age in years. And so knowing not only how old they are, but gathering information about what their developmental level is. This is where the school staff and or parent or guardian who are present are going to be extremely helpful. School staff, especially for our rural schools, know these kiddos very, very well. And so they will be able to share information with you on what their abilities may or may not be. Letting us know at the beginning of a call, this is a student who is autistic and nonverbal. Those things we're going to look to them to provide us so that we can guide our care. involving the primary caregiver, if they're able, is helpful. It puts kids at ease, it makes them feel safe. So if a parent is available who works in the school, I think getting them and having them participate in the call is always good, helping to limit that fear. Gain engagement and trust. And this happens differently depending on the child's age, but we often will use little prompts or things that will help kind of lighten the mood. So for example, we may use little stuffed animals or things to gain their attention. Have the bear talk to the student if they're younger, to just really kind of put them at ease, get a smile on their face if we can. Letting them know not only who you are, but what you're going to do and why you're going to do it. Letting children know ahead of time is extremely important. They don't like surprises. That will keep them on edge the entire call. So telling them that, I'm going to tell you everything that I'm going to look at and everything I'm going to do, everything I need you to do before we do any of it. Letting them know step by step what's coming next. When appropriate, letting them touch and feel the equipment or the peripherals before you use them. So if you're going to look in their ear, for example, letting them touch that otoscope piece, maybe having your helper, who is the secretary or the administrator, shine it on their hand, letting them know and see that this isn't going to hurt. There's no pokes or shots with this. Set expectations. Children are natural people pleasers, and they will work really hard to try and do their best of whatever is asked of them. But it's a matter of taking time to really set those expectations, providing that really clear explanation of what's going to happen, giving them time to get comfortable with the peripherals, and then letting them know what their job is. So I now need to look in your ear because I have heard that that's what's bothering you. I'm going to do that with this special piece of equipment that has a special camera and light on the end. And it's going to go just a little ways into your ear. And here, I'm going to let you touch it. I'm going to let you shine it on your hand so that you kind of know what it feels like. And now I'm going to look in your ear. So your job while I do this is to sit as still as a statue so that I can see what I need to see, and then I can tell you what we need to do to help you feel better. Providing distraction, again, with animals, jokes, anything like that will help the child just relax. If they're able, teaching them deep breathing techniques, using bubbles or books, those are all other examples. So if able, another example would be maybe you need to listen to their lungs, and you're having a hard time getting them to understand how to take those big deep breaths in and out for you to hear adequately and provide direction. Little tidbit is you could use a pretend flower, and on your end, you could hold that flower near the camera and say, so I'm going to listen to your breathing, but to do that, I need you to take big breaths in and out. So I'm going to hold this flower by the camera, and I want you to pretend like you're smelling it. So you're going to take a big breath in and then blow it out and pretend like you're smelling the flower. Those kind of things really help kids follow that direction that you're providing and meeting those expectations that you need. Introductions are important. Everybody needs to know who everybody is. So making sure everyone identifies themselves and what your role is. Hi, I'm Nurse Amanda, and this is Rainbow Unicorn or Rainbow Bear or whatever little prop you may have. I understand that you have an earache, and I'm going to help you with that. Making sure that the assistant who is with you has helping with that patient identification depending on their age. Other ways that you can do that, if they don't know their name and date of birth, again, using the staff's help, using a parent help if they're available. But we do have access with our equipment to log into each school district's documentation system. And so there are other ways with younger kids that you can help identify them, asking them their name, maybe verifying who their teacher is, what mom or dad's name is. We have that information available, so that can help us do that proper patient identification as well. Excuse me. And then moving forward, you know, now that I know who you are, I need you to tell me what doesn't feel good or what hurts, and having them describe that to you, and then basing your assessment questions off of that. Telemedicine, you have to rely a lot on what you see and what you're told. There to help guide what you need to evaluate or assess more closely. And so it's knowing and recognizing what their main concern is and then starting to ask them questions. When did your tummy ache start? Did you eat breakfast today? Have you gone to the bathroom? Those kind of questions will help you gain more information and help you determine what you may need to assess more closely. After having that description of what the student's complaint is, then again, guiding that care step-by-step with the student so that they know what's coming next, making those clear expectations so that they know what you need them to do. All of these things will really help set you up for an environment of success. It will help build that patient-provider relationship and will really help guide you in knowing what your recommendations need to be. And those vary. They vary from whether that's they can return to class right away, they need to rest in the health office, the referral to medical care, maybe just have to go home for the day, all the way up to this is an emergent situation and we need you to call 911. And then continuing to provide that care and that constant evaluation to the patient while the emergency services are on their way. That's all I have for you today. I really hope that this information was helpful to you. And thank you again for having me. Christy?
Yes, thank you, Allison. So thank you again for listening to this Avera eCare On Demand webinar. If you have questions or want more information about this topic or Avera eCare in general, you can email myself, Christy, KRISTI.Seidel, @avera.org. And you can also go to our website to see these more on-demand webinars at averaecare.org. Thank you again and have a great day.